Since you came along, you sex a thing. Hey guys, and welcome to our summary build video for Beast, our Chev Silverado 2500 HD. So many of you on social media have been asking us constantly for a walk around vid, and that's what we're going to do for you. But a couple of things firstly, let me just say that if you were to do a build like this, you would probably be change out of about 300,000 to get it done. We haven't paid anywhere near as much as that because I, up until going full-time traveling, I worked for a GMSV dealer Bay City in Frankston, and through my contacts I haven't paid anywhere near that. But also should point out that you can still see the same sunsets, the same sunrises, the same beaches if you had a two-wheel drive and a swag, so you don't need to have a setup like this. But as full-time tourers and as someone who has sold American trucks, I always wanted to build one, and we have this to tow our 3.2 ton caravan. Okay, now a couple of things about the vehicle itself straight out of the box. GMSV remanufactured vehicle, Silverado 2500 HD, 6.6 litre V8 turbo diesel Duramax with a 10-speed Allison transmission, producing 332 kilowatts of power, 1,234 newton meters of torque. And that's straight out of the box, works out at about 91 kilowatts of power per ton. Those are impressive numbers on their own. These things are designed for towing. When you buy the truck through a GMSV dealer here in Australia, you'll get two options, either as an MB1 or an MB2. MB1 keeps the designated vehicle at 4.5 ton or 4495 to be precise, and you can drive it on a car license. This one is designated as a light truck at 5,148 kilograms. Therefore, it's an MB2. And you need a light truck license to drive it, which I do have. The benefit of that is that it gives you more payload. So you only get, off the top of my head, about 750 kilos of payload as an MB1, but you get nearly 1,400 kilos as an MB2. With the 1,400 kilos, that then allows us to do a lot more in terms of the build, and also registered as a light truck because the criteria for building a vehicle under the National Truck Code as opposed to, or National Heavy Vehicle Code as opposed to the Retail Vehicle Code, is very, very different. It's a lot more grey area, and we can do a lot more with the trucks and get away with it legally. This truck has been looked over by the authorities, and it has been passed as legal. Just in terms of its weight, I am right on about 5.1 ton fully loaded with all fluids, and I'll go over the tank sizes and things shortly. So with passengers and things, I'm right down to a double Twix bar and a can of Coke will just about put me over. No, look, I've got about 50 kilos fully loaded. All right, so I'm okay, because I'm not going to be adding any more extra to this vehicle. All right, so let's go back in history a little bit. And let's start with the steps for where we got to today, all right? And then after that, we'll come back and I'll go through the specifics of some of the build components. Enjoy the build vid and we'll come back and we'll talk soon. So if we're going to start from the beginning, the best place would be at GMSV's specialist remanufacturing facility in Dandenong, South Victoria. This is where the vehicles are built by GMSV through a company called Promoso, which is a division of Walkinshaw Group. The engineering required to remanufacture a left-hand drive vehicle to a right-hand drive vehicle occurs here, and there is a lot more to it than just cut and paste. And thanks to the guys from GMSV and Walkinshaw, we were given a tour of the facility. All vehicles are shipped over from the USA. It takes about 6 to 8 weeks by shipping. Then eventually they will arrive at the factory in Dandenong South. All the vehicles are stripped right down to the chassis and engine block, and all the parts are retained for engineering and repurposing within the same vehicle build wherever possible. And that includes every single piece of trim and carpet, along with the entire wiring looms. The whole firewall is cut out and made from scratch in a mirror image in order to accept all the original wiring and fixtures that the left-hand drive version carries. And this is where the smart engineering comes into play. Rather than make an entirely new mirror image steering box to suit right-hand drive, Promoso has devised a method of retaining the original steering box, which, with a few small modifications, can be then remounted upside down on the right-hand chassis rail to suit the right-hand drive requirement, and that enables the vehicle to then retain as many of its original parts and serial numbers as possible.
Come out. We add our own bolt-on mounts, which is this one and this one, and then we add what we call a mitre box, which is this here, which gives you more extension of the steering arm and more angle back towards the steering column, which gets it around the air conditioning compressor area that we were having trouble with.
The dash is rebuilt so that the angle of viewing is relevant to a driver of a right-hand drive vehicle rather than left-hand drive. Once the vehicles complete their remanufacturing, they are then put through a rigorous quality control process to ensure that they comply with Australian design regulations. Okay, so I should reiterate, when I say fully loaded at about 5.1 ton, I'm talking about passengers, fluids, and everything. Now, how good was that remanufacturing video? So GMSV plant in Dandenong South in Melbourne, Victoria. Basically, they cut the truck right down to its bare bone chassis and rebuild it back up. It's a remanufacturing, it's not a conversion. So conversion, they can cut and paste and bend wires and tubes. These things are completely rebuilt. Now the company Promoso, Walkinshaw and GMSV company, they basically 3D print any left-hand parts that need to be right-hand when they did the original, I guess, the prototype vehicle, and now they produce the correct parts they need. So absolute full remanufacturing, spectacular facility and spectacular process. Okay, so let's have a look at the truck as it's finished. So let's spin around and have a bit of a look. Okay, so this is Beast. Sam nicknamed him Beast. Our caravan, 3.2 ton, great Aussie Explorer caravan, is Beauty, hence Beauty and the Beast, all right? So where do I start? Let's start at the front. It's probably the easiest. Firstly, big red gear lighting, okay? So we've got the 7-inch main driving lights, and I've got a 40-inch bar up on the top. The bar itself is an Addictive Desert design, so it's an American-built front bar specifically for these vehicles. Within that, it also has its own 40-inch light bar, stealth pod lights on each side, and inside that, we've also got a worn 12,000-pound Evo winch, okay? So look, 12,000 pounds, probably not enough if I'm needing to get out of the scrap fully loaded with the truck and the van, but with a couple of snatch traps and, you know, a bit of patience, we should be able to at least do what we need to do if required. A winch is always one of those things that you have and not need, rather than need and not have, all right? So that's the front setup. Under the bonnet, nothing's changed. We've done nothing to it. It's straight out of the box vehicle, all right? Around the side, the bushwhacker flares, which give us that extra bit of space outside of the standard guards for the rudder. All right, 37-inch, 12.5x20, Maxxis Razor AT tyres. So AT, all terrains, rather than mud tyres, because we are a tourer for all intents and purposes. Yes, we do a bit of off-road, and these things are very capable off-road. I know someone's going to ask me that question, but these are an all-terrain. The Maxxis Razor all-terrains allow us to do off-road because they are an aggressive all-terrain tyre, all right. Fuel sledge rims, again, 20-inch fuel sledge rims, and I reckon that's a great package. Heavy tyre, not cheap, but looks the mint on the truck. The lift is a 5-inch rough country lift. Now, I know there's going to be plenty out there that, you know, rough country, what a load of crap, that's garbage, it's, you know, stick with the Fox, stick with it, you know. You can have that argument, and that is going to be a Ford versus Holden argument. You know, you're going to have the loves and you're going to have the haters. But I can tell you that as a salesperson for GMSV truck builds, we have used a lot of rough country equipment and it's never failed on us. I put rough country on this, I've never had a problem with it. 11,000 Ks we've got on it now, so far no problems at all, and it's done the job for us. Yes, someone's going to come back and say, oh yeah, but what about when you get to 70,000 Ks or whatever? Well, I'll deal with that problem when it comes. But I can tell you now that as far as I'm concerned, value for money and for its result, the Rough Country product is as good as any out there. But I will reiterate by saying that that should be the Vertex Rough Country, not your standard. So your standard shocks I probably wouldn't put on this, particularly a vehicle of this build, but certainly your Vertex adjustable suspension you can put on this. Now it's 5-inch lift. 5-inch lift includes a diff drop box. So everything goes from there rather than that, it actually gets lifted, all right? So your whole suspension sits quite relaxed. All right, so everything is lifted, not stretched like that, okay? So it's a 5-inch full lift with a diff drop box. And we'll try and get in a bit closer and have a bit of a look in there. Okay, so you can see the Rough Country Vertex with the 8 adjustments, okay? I run these fairly high, mainly for comfort factor, but it's doesn't require any cutting. It is a straight suspension changeover. Okay, so 5-inch lift. Is it practical? No, it's not. All right? Would I do it again? Probably not. But would I do it this time, or am I happy with it this time? Absolutely. All right? The reason I did it was because it suited the 37-inch tires with the 20-inch rims, so that I wouldn't have to do any cutting in that cert to allow for full lock turning. All right, it's just something I wanted to do. I could get away with not doing the full lift, that's not a problem, but that is just something I wanted to do. So yes, we use a little step ladder and that sort of thing to get in and out of it, and I'll show you that in a minute. But and Sam uses a trampoline to get up into the passenger seat when it's a travel day. All right, so up on the roof, wedge tail rack, okay. At the time of the build, tradesmen were only doing a rack that suited, but now the others like Wino and Yakima do them, but this one's a wedge tail rack. They're all pretty much the same. 4 max tracks, I've got 2 Yakima bike loaders up there. Be interesting to put the bikes up there, but we'll deal with that. That's only if we ever need to take the bike or want to take the bikes off the front of the van and go somewhere with them. And on the other side, I've actually got a high lift jack attachment, but at the moment, I haven't got a high lift jack and I'm not really sure whether I'll go down that path. But that's up on the roof, plus obviously the light bar, which I showed you before. Let's have a quick look inside. Okay, just quickly inside, safety Dave camera for the back of the caravan. I've got an iPad here with HEMA maps on it, so that when we're touring and we're running Google Maps up on the screen, that's all fine until you run out of phone reception. So then I run HEMA maps, which is on the GPS on the iPad, but that also has our other apps like Wikicamps and everything else. So that, all that information's there. We run a Oricom dual antenna UHF. So up on the roof, I've got 2 antennas. Both of them go into the one system and they will work out which antenna provides the best signal. So that runs into the UHF. And then we also have 2 Oricom, 2-watt handhelds for just general communication around the campsites. All right. But everything else is all pretty much standard. What I will point out though, if you can get in there close, that one little switch there, just there, that one little switch operates all of our lights on full boom. I only ever think I'm going to need all the lights on or all the lights off. I'm not going to be, I'll just have that bar and those two lights. It's either all or nothing as far as I'm concerned. So if I need to burn the eyelids of a kangaroo in front of me, well then that's what he's going to cop, all right? And that one switch, nice and neat, thanks to my mate James North, wired that up for us, nice and neat, it looks great. So that That's the truck. And I'll actually talk about who contributed to the build at the end. Okay, the canopy on the back. So we've removed the tub and we went with a tray canopy setup from Mitz Alloy. Now, we'll put the link in below if I can't add in Mitz Alloy's walk around on the actual canopy, because they've done a ripping job on it, and I'll show you quickly, but I won't sort of go into too much details because I will do my own walk around as well. But Mitz Alloy tray canopy setup for the American truck. So it's a nice big 7 foot tray with a 6 foot canopy, loads of space in it. All right, so let's have a quick look. As you can see, she is loaded up because we are full-time travelers. So we got lots of stuff thrown in here. I mean, I've got my whippersnipper. Sam's got a massage table in there. We've got plenty of drawers and storage space. So this is our storage side, all right? Won't go into too much detail on that. What I should point out too is the artwork. How good was this from Benesigns in Pakenham, Victoria? What they did here with a full PPF coat on the whole vehicle over the top of the artwork as well is spectacular. Love it. It is an image of Big Red in just outside Birdsville. And it shows what we're about as in terms of our travels, all right? But as I said, I will go through more about the canopy on its own. Coming around the back. Nice, decent exhaust. That is straight out of the box. Nothing out of there. We've got the Jenny torsion hitch. Because the Boss torsion hitch, these things aren't cheap and they are certainly bloody heavy, but they do the trick in terms of balancing that rebound between your van and your truck. Nice and neat. I will just briefly mention the Bush Company rooftop tent, and we do also have the Bush Company 270 awning, but again, I'll do more of a detailed vid on those, and I'll add that in as well. Okay, and we access it from behind. Two jerry cans, 20 litres each. We carry water in these because in the van, we've also got two more jerry cans, one 20 litres of petrol and one 20 litres of diesel, mainly for our diesel heater and the petrol for the whippersnipper and the chainsaw and things like that. So that's it, moving around. Having a quick look at the canopy on this side. It's where it mainly all happens. So we've got the Bushman 130 litre upright fridge. Pull out pantry. Storage drawers for all your kitchen appliances. We've got coffee machine in there, 12 volt toaster, things like that. Workbench, and as you can see, it is quite high. I do use a stool, which is around somewhere, but to use this. Sam doesn't cook on this. She'll either use the back tray, which is actually more at stomach level, or we'll just cook off the caravan. So, but that's a bit of an idea. In this particular cupboard, we also have an ARB dual air compressor and all the bits and pieces and attachments I need. So if we are off-road, if we're going to a beach, something like that, and I'm airing down, airing back up, it's got its own air source, okay? In terms of the canopy itself, right, so on top of the clamshell rooftop tent, we've got a 180 watt solar panel, and that powers into 200 amp hours of lithium, a 2000 watt inverter, all red arc and managed by the red arc management system. So,
okay,
as you can see there. Now the truck themselves, unfortunately, yes, they do run AdBlue, and to give you an idea, you probably go through about 10 litres of AdBlue roughly per 3,000 kilometres at the moment. Now, the diesel, we do have a Titan 211 litre long range tank underneath. The standard tank is 136 litres, so that takes it 211. And as a full-time tourer, pulling a 3.2 van most of the time, it works for us. Fuel economy. A lot of you are going to ask me that. Okay. 11,000 Ks in at the moment. When I'm running the truck on its own and not towing the van, I'm running around about 20, 21 litres per 100 Ks. When I put the van on the back, I'm running at about 25 litres per. Okay. That's rough and dirty. It depends on where we are, what road conditions are like, etc. There's so many things that come into account there. We did nearly 3,000 kilometres in Tasmania and a lot of heavy hills and that sort of thing. So that makes a big difference to say when you're towing in the outback where it's just flat. But that gives you a bit of an idea. As I said, everything else is pretty much kept standard. I think that's it. I don't know if there's anything else I can mention. So thanks for listening, guys. Hopefully I've answered most of your questions. If you've got any more, certainly reach out. Put a comment below or send us an email or a text or whatever you feel comfortable with. And I'll answer as best I can for you. As a former GMSV salesperson, I have a pretty good knowledge of these vehicles. I do still have contact with Bay City in Frankston. I've got a pretty good idea on what your wait times and your pricings are. If anything else I can help you with, reach out and let me know. Now, the thanks list. This is going to be the long one, and I will apologise if I forget anybody. So firstly, as I mentioned before, thanks to James North, the auto electrician, for the light setup, and also the Anderson plugs and the safety Dave at the back. James Morecambe, Morgan Smith, guys from Off-Road Industries and Auto Works Car Care, my apologies. Those guys have been absolutely brilliant for the most part in terms of the lift, all that aspect of it. I probably forgot to mention as well that I do have Boss airbags on the back as well, more as helpers for the when I am towing the van to help just level it all out. And as I said, Auto Works Car Care and Lowdown Industries and Off-Road Industries, you guys have just been spectacular for all that you've done for me, and I really appreciate that. Mod Kings in Sydney for the rims and the rubber got me in at short notice, able to get in what I needed when it was very tough to get the rims and rubber. They got it done. Guys, again, thank you so much. Mitz Alloy, cannot thank you guys enough for the work that you did for us in terms of the canopy. It has been just brilliant. Absolutely love the canopy and what we can do with it and how it works for us. Everybody has different needs for different canopies. This definitely works for us, and we really appreciate the work that you guys did. Ultimate Off-Road for the supply and fit of the Bush Company equipment, the 270 awning and the rooftop tent. Brilliant guys, thank you so much for getting that done. And that was also right at the last minute before we had to go to Tassie. So thanks for getting that done for us. Have I forgotten anyone else? I don't think so. I've already mentioned, obviously, earlier, Benner signs in Pakenham for the artwork and the PPF, and I really appreciate the work you've done, guys, and it just looks spectacular and stands out, and everybody loves it. So I think that's it for the build, but the one most important one that I absolutely have to thank is Bay City GMSV in Frankston. Adam, thank you so much for not only for the time that I spent there as an employee and the development that you provided, the environment that you provided for me, but also the help in getting this vehicle so that I could actually do what I now do. So probably the biggest thanks goes out to Adam, Heath, the rest of the guys at Bay City GMSV in Frankston, Victoria. And if you want to know more about any of those, or you want contacts or details, guys, just reach out. Thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. Heading out on our own with our hope in the clouds. And we're starting to see that we're onto something. Feel it coming. We'll keep running. Nothing in our way. And we got no reason to wait. Let the journey take you where it wants to. We'll continue to find our way through anything we face. We got what it takes. Here we go.